I spent my childhood days at my grandfather's house, who was living in the old part of the city. It was such a wonderful experience for me. It was a kind of a coexistence, people all around, so much of familiarity, so much of chit-chatting, caring for each other. After supper, people would gather around my grandfather. There would be that hookah circulated amongst each other. They would smoke the hookah and talk about various things that they had read in the paper or that they had experienced in the about politics, about religion. And I would just in the corner, I would just sit with my grandmother, who was watching everything and taking care of these guests. You know. She would read a book on Mahabharata or Ramayana, and in the book there were many, many illustrations, quite many were by Raja Ravi Varma, who is now very famous, and was very wondered to see all those mythological stories. My childhood had a lot of fascination for, I mean, there was hardly any demarcating line between reality and mythology. It was all one. And somehow, when I used to sit for painting, these images occur, and halfway they change. Even the theme of some realistic things change into kind of a mythology, and so many images come one after the other. I was brought up in quite a religious background, in the sense our family lived in different stratas, no? Because my father was an industrialist, and so many modern things was also there. But then my grandmother or my mother were performing pujas, and there were so many times the pandit would come to practice some ceremonies, maybe on the birthday. After five daughters, I was the only son, so I was very precious. So on my birthday, a pandit would come and perform a ritual. My horoscope were also shown to the pandits. Everybody was kind of, you know, in that time, even when they go to the guru, they would ask for a boon, in one sense that, Swamiji, I have so many problems, and then he would, you please bless us. Amongst this God-fearing person, so religious person, I always felt that there is some kind of an insecurity in them. So in one painting, I have shown a helpless person, in the sense he has no clothes on him. He is just waiting for one planet to come and one to go. As consult a palmist or an astrologer, he said that you have a problem with this planet. Saturn is harassing you. But after this date, the particular guru is coming into your particular position of your horoscope, and then you'll be happy. In that way, the whole life, the man sort of in expectation of some hope, something good will happen. They just wait for the things to happen, which never happen, and they just finish up their life in almost a kind of a sea of desires, pains, pathos. At certain place, time, when I feel that it is becoming a painting, then also I get little bit alert that I don't want to make it a serious painting. I want to have a gossip. I want to have fun. So I break that kind of a thing, that chain of my thoughts, and try to have fun. Try to strike some odd things, which may not be totally irrelevant. It might be relevant to my own logic. But then I start with one subject in my mind, but end up anywhere else, wherever it takes me. And then again I try to ask the painting, know what you are. So then new meanings have come up. I just try to make new stories looking at my painting. Talking about this, my experience with the holy places, holy man, here in this Guardians of the Divine Elephant, I have shown two priests. I mean, one is scratching the eye, ear, or one is scratching the neck, kind of. Of course, they consider themselves as the guardians, but they are not fully aware or conscious of what great thing that have, maybe philosophy or ritual or even the great paintings that are around. But still they consider themselves as guardians, and that's why they are scratching the ears and neck and trying to gauge what's life about. I'm always fascinated about yoga. There are also here classes of yoga that by performing this kind of a posture, I mean, you will gain this thing, that kind of some physical things or spiritual benefits. Then they talk about Kundalini, that serpent power sort of, you know, rising, and then everything is open to you. You know everything when the serpent power is raised, I mean, awaken. A person is upside down performing Shirsasana, and he is meditating on various chakras in him, and a cats and even the bees, they are wondering that for we are just cats, and that's fine, we are a cat or a bee is a bee, but to be a human being, why you have to be do so many things? I mean, you are human, why need to do so much things? Some of my friends who were going to yoga class, they said that, oh, in the morning, no, so people when they are performing Shirsasana upside down, they fart, and it's kind of a, we don't like to go kind of, you know, sort of. And that made me very amused. So that was turned into a kind of a clouds, and then I made a little rain. And then because of the sound of that thing, a peacock runs away. I mean, these are all the stories which the paintings dictate, which the canvas dictates. But then at the end, there is always a kind of some new stories which has come up from a basic, some little story about a yoga performer farting in the class. Once we had been to Haridwar, the holy place where river Ganges flows. Everywhere there were sculptures of Shiva and the river Ganga descending on his hair. Then statues of river Ganga personified as a goddess standing on a crocodile. So here I have tried to show Shiva waiting for the river Ganga to descend on his hair. Shiva is already a nandi, a bull with him, a cobra on his neck. When Ganga is descending, she has a crocodile. So this cobra and the nandi are thinking that now where will we accommodate this third animal? The element was just to show that crocodile, you know, diagonal, which made my painting. In so much of my works, crows come in many ways. I mean, it's not always that they are used as symbolizing something. But somehow, when I'm sitting in my studio, when the doors are open, in the terrace, so many crows come. Of course, sometimes I throw some biscuits or something. But then they are kind of an exhibitionist. No? I mean, they want to show what they can do. They make various sounds, various acrobatics. And somehow the geometry of the crow, the color of the crow, I think it's the most vibrant kind of a bird, but I have used it in very different ways. In the Krishna legend, it is said that Krishna lifted the Mount Govardhana to protect the villagers from the heavy rains which were unleashed by Indra, the lord of rains, so that the whole mountain became a kind of an umbrella to protect the villagers from these heavy rains. So I thought that as I am writing and studying on this Krishna theme, why should I not make a Krishna myself? But it didn't click to me that it's hardly any sense to do Krishna now. And somehow it turned out to be a person who is maybe a kind of a politician or a leader, somebody. So here in this context, I say the person who is sitting beneath the mountain says that you carry the burden, I will play the flute. Krishna was a flute player, divine flute player. So he is asking the people not to hold the mountain. and he is enjoying the flute. So it's a fun on the present situation that everything has to be, all the kinds of hardships are to be borne by the people. And their leaders really enjoy and just point fingers to them that now do this, now do that. I call this painting as Pan India. You know Pan, the betel leaf that many Indians eat. And they spit the red thing on the walls or at various places. And also it is known that when your mind is in the vacuum stage or shunya stage, so many new ideas come. So this is a humor on our Indian habit. And a pan eater at the time of spitting gets that moment of ecstasy and all the new ideas emerge from his mind. When this element of fun, kind of a magic or humor comes, I feel now it's time I should stop.